So coming back to the talk of today, you notice that in our everyday life, robots are more and more present. For example, we presented before some vacuum cleaner robot, like the Roomba, but you have also more complex ones, such as the Android or the retail assistant. Those robots are really performant in what they are doing, but they have two main disadvantages. The first one is that they are increasingly complex and they are difficult to maintain. And most of the time they are also extremely costly. So the second disadvantage is that they are bound to a set of tasks that they can perform. And if you want to extend their capabilities, then you will need either to change the platform itself or it will be quite difficult. So the question we could ask ourselves is, what if we would start with basic blocks, basic building blocks that have a given functionalities that you could assemble together in order to form a robot that better suits your task? And even better, what if those blocks could assemble together in an autonomous fashion in order to create the robot that is best suited for a given problem? And this is what I'm going to talk about today. So, first of all, I will give you a brief introduction on modular robotics, and then present briefly three main concepts, three main research studies that we did on this subject. And finally, we give you some application of this concept in the domain of smart environments before concluding my presentation. So to introduce the concept, I'm going to use a Disney movie, or part of it. And here in this movie called Big Hero 6, the main character designed a modular robot and he's presenting it in a big exhibition. This is going to do my work for a few minutes.
This is a microbot. It doesn't look like much, but when it links up with the rest of its pals, things get a little more interesting. I think what I want them to do, they do it. The applications for this tech are limitless. Construction. What used to take teams of people working by hand for months or years can now be accomplished by one person. And that's just the beginning.
So I must say that the main character is extremely optimistic. So he's saying that just the beginning, for us that's really the ultimate goal, that we like to see. But this movie is quite great because it presents basic concepts in the domain. For example, you have seen that the robot at the beginning, when they go out of the trash bin, I mean they come on the ground, and they need to learn how to move on this free environment. And this is a part called locomotion. Also there is a part where the robot self-reconfigure, change the shape to adapt to the user needs. And this is what we call self-reconfiguration. And finally, there is a part of control. Here, the main character is using a brain interface in order to directly control the robot. And this is also the part regarding interaction that I'm going to talk about later. So, in real world, modular robots look more like something like that. So those are two examples, quite recent one, both from MIT and from University of Pennsylvania. On one side you have a robot called Emperor, so it's a momentum-driven robot that can connect with other robots using magnets. And on this side, it's a robot called Smorse and that uses its connection mechanism in order to rotate and to move freely in the environment. So let's say that it's a bit less impressive than what we have seen before in the Disney movie, but that's a good step forward. So in our case, in our lab, what we want to do is use those robots in order to build furniture that can move, that can change the shape autonomously, and that can adapt to the user needs through the day. And we want to use that in the context of assistive environments. So we would like to build basic building blocks, like I presented before, that would be able, once connected together, to help a person into her everyday life. And we derive a set of basic functionalities out of that. For example, a robot that could prevent fall or that could help a person recover from it. In order to tackle this challenge, what we did is we bought a robot from Roombox. It has 3 degrees of freedom, able of continuous rotation. And contrary to the robot I showed you before, it has a gripping mechanism that is mechanical here, and that is based on small grippers that comes out. So one module will be able, using this connection mechanism, to connect to another one autonomously and to lift it. So you have to keep in mind that this robot is quite small. It's 22 centimeters high, 11 centimeters width, and it's weighing around 1.4 kilograms, which is quite heavy. But already one module can locomote, so can move on a grid of connector like this one, can climb on the wall, and can also climb on the ceiling in an autonomous manner. So you have quite some freedom with already one module. And what I'm going to show you is those three aspects, how we applied, I mean, our robot to reconfiguration, locomotion, and interaction. So I will start by self-reconfiguration. So this is what we can obtain, in fact, if we apply self-reconfiguration algorithm to our robot. On one side, you have robots that evolve on a grid. I will give you more detail of what it's done in the next slides. And you have also robots that can manipulate objects, maybe. So that's supposed to manipulate objects and so manipulate those objects in order to form more complex structure afterwards. So the first thing that you have seen is called gradient-based self-reconfiguration. The idea has been introduced by Professor Kasper Solzer in 2006 in the domain of modular robotics. And you can see, in fact, the goal is to create a shape starting with small sliding cubes that represent your modules. And to do so, the idea is quite simple. Roughly speaking, you define into your final shape some attractors, think of them as magnets, that will attract the different modules towards the final position. And so you can build the final structure this way. So what we did in our lab is just take this approach and adapt it to our own hardware. And to do so, we design a framework that is composed of two main parts. A part that is specific to the hardware we're using, so to our robot modules, and that manage all what's related to the movement of the robot itself. Motion planning, collision checking, and so on. And on top of that, we built hardware-independent parts that manage the attractor availability in the world and also the strengths of the grid. And this is the result that we obtain. So here you can see the different modules goes from one position to the other into this structure environment using a pre-computed database of shape. So they will check into this database and say, okay, what is the set of movements that will bring me closer to the seat, closer to the attractors? And they will choose this one. And you can, you might have seen on this movie here on the side, but we can also go off-grid, meaning that we are not bound to the grid there, but we can also build something that is a bit more roundish, for example. So we have quite a versatile alphabet of shapes that can be built. Now, if we want to build the table, for example, that is there, we need to add something more to a simple self-reconfiguration. We need to be able to integrate objects that we call passive objects and that have no motors and no actuation inside. And to do so, the problem is the following. You have a group of robots over there, a group of passive parts, and the goal would be for those robots to manipulate those parts in order to end up in this configuration. And this is what we are trying to do with this framework, is in fact doing this manipulation part over there.